We're recording.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So the vastus medialis is one of a group of muscles called quadriceps, which are located in the anterior compartment of the thigh. The other muscles of the group being vastus lateralis, rectus femoris, and deep rectus femoris is vastus intermedius. The muscles of the quadriceps converge distally onto the quadriceps tendon and then insert via the patella onto the tibial tuberosity. The vastus medialis takes its origin from the medial part of the intertrochanteric line, round onto the posterior aspect of the shaft of the femur, down the medial lip of the linea aspera, and onto the medial supracondylar line. The fibers of the vastus medialis wrap around the medial part of the thigh and insert, as we've said, onto the quadriceps tendon and the medial patella retinaculum. By convention, the vastus medialis is divided into two portions, a proximal longus part and an oblique part distally. Whether these two parts are in fact separate muscles is a matter of some controversy. What is beyond dispute, however, is that the angle of the muscle fibers with respect to the femoral axis changes down the length of the muscle, with the most distal fibers being almost horizontal. The oblique angulation of the distal VMO fibers means that they can exert a medial pull on the patella during forced extension of the knee, preventing lateral excursion of the patella that might otherwise occur due to the pull of the quadriceps and the Q angle at the junction of the tibia and femur. VMO insufficiency is thought to be implicated in patellofemoral pain syndrome, a very common complaint in young active individuals that can result from patella maltracking. One of our earlier studies found evidence that the VMO fiber angle and the insertion level, that's to say how far down the medial border of the patella the muscle inserts, can be affected by the activity level of the individual. In this study, we set out to quantify those differences by investigating two different populations with distinctly different activity levels.
Although it is now recognised that there can be other drivers of patellofemoral pain other than the VMO, there is still uncertainty surrounding the VMO's exact role. For example, recent literature has moved away from investigating force generation and instead has focused on timing of firing relative to the vastus lateralis. The results, however, are inconclusive and further complicated by the presence of VMO delay in many healthy subjects. Fitting with the decades of inconclusive literature on VMO training and patellofemoral pain, use of VMO exercises have come in and out of vogue in clinical practice. The type of exercises and exercise dosage has become more sophisticated over time, but there is still a paucity of clarity on what VMO exercise is actually doing and who can be identified as suitable candidates for it.
We are going to measure the subject's VMO fiber angle and insertion level of his right knee. Make sure the subject's positioned supine on the bed and stabilise the distal limb with a pillow. First of all, we start off by palpating the medial and lateral borders of the patella, and also the apex and the superior border. Then mark on the pen, the apex and superior border. Then work at the midpoint of the patella using the digital calipers and mark this on. Next, we feel for the subject's asus. Then, using the metal ruler, draw a line through the midpoint of the patella. This corresponds to the femoral axis. So, using the ultrasound probe, we scan to find the subject's muscle belly. You can see it here on the screen as it inserts onto the femur. Once we find this, we rotate the probe. Muscle fibers can be seen here horizontally across the screen. Once we find this point, freeze the screen and then mark on the midpoint of the ultrasound probe on either side. We then rotate the probe back to being perpendicular to the femoral axis, unfreeze the screen and move the probe down until we can't see any of the muscle belly inserting onto the patella. We then mark this point again, and we finish with the ultrasound machine. We then draw through the two marks either side of the fibre angle and follow this line down so that it transects the femoral axis. Then draw a line through the point where we couldn't see the muscle fibres to work out the insertion level. Then we use the protractor to work out the fibre angle. So you can see in this patient the fibre angle is 50 degrees. And then we calculate the length of the patella using the calipers, 48.62 millimetres. And the insertion level is 17.58 millimetres.
Our results show that the mean VMO fibre angle for the athletic group was 67.8 degrees and for the sedentary group 53.6 degrees, and this result was highly statistically significant. The insertion ratio for the athletic group was 43% and for the sedentary group 39.5%. Although the athletic group had a higher mean insertion ratio, the result was not found to be statistically significant. When VMO angle is plotted against TEGNA score, there is found to be a high degree of correlation. Though this correlation is not seen when the insertion ratio is plotted against TEGNA score. This diagram represents the relative angle and insertion ratio in sedentary and athletic study groups. The sedentary study group is shown in red and the athletic group in blue.
Our investigation creates a new, fresh perspective that the benefits gained from VMO training may in fact arise from changes in muscle architecture and not necessarily force generation or timing. Furthermore, it stimulates a new line of inquiry, and that is prediction of who may be the most suitable candidates for VMO work. Given the prevalence of patellofemoral pain and the economic burden in primary care, our team will be continuing this work in order to try and answer these more sophisticated but highly clinically relevant questions.